Hello, I'm Bob Cates. I'm the Toronto chair of Canadian Friends of Peace Now chapter, and I'm extremely pleased to see such a good attendance, so many of our friends and so many new people here. Canadian Friends of Peace Now are partners with Peace Now, Shalom Hashav, which is Israel's leading peace movement. It's a Zionist non-government organization that promotes the two-state solution to the Israel-Palestine conflict. You can find out more about us on our website, peacenowcanada.org. And we also really hope that you will consider supporting us. You can send in a donation right away. And in addition, we're going to be doing a telethon over the next week or so. And we will try to catch anybody who has not donated yet. Our webinar today is how we got to where we are in the Israeli-Palestine conflict, and most importantly, how things could move forward. Our guest is the very eminent Dr. Shaul Arieli, and he will speak for roughly 40 minutes. After that, we will have time for questions and answers, and we're not going to be doing it live. We've got a very large group here. So what we're asking is, please type in questions in the Q&A screen at the bottom of your, the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And Daniela Weissman, who is up here, you can hopefully see her, will be monitoring the questions and will try to get as many out as possible. And when you put in your questions, if at all possible, if you don't want them anonymous, tell us where you are calling from. And also, if you have a name that people typically mispronounce, correct us and tell us how to pronounce it. Put a phonetic spelling. As noted, the webinar will be recorded. It'll be on our website, but it's much more fun live. So it's my great pleasure to introduce our guest speaker. Dr. Shaul Arieli is a leading participant, expert, and educator on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. He's written widely on the subject and holds several distinguished teaching and research positions. Earlier in his life, he served with distinction in the Israeli Defense Forces. While still in the military, he became involved in official negotiations with the Palestinians. After his retirement from the IDF in 2001, he has dedicated himself to advancing an agreement with the Palestinians that would lead to lasting peace. Last week, I downloaded his book, Atlas of the Jewish-Palestinian Conflict, from our invitation to today's webinar. It provides an exceptional visual representation of the history of the conflict and will be a valued resource as we try to increase our understanding. For those who have not seen it, we'll put a download link on our website. Dr. Arieli, over to you.
Thank you, Bob, and good afternoon to everyone. I'm very happy to be here and to have in this meeting a discussion about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And for this, I would like to share my my presentation, this one, and to start by saying that the development of the Israeli border, in fact, it's the history of the Israeli-Arab conflicts. So I chose the main milestones in this conflict to describe what happened with the Israeli borders and also what happened between the Israeli and the Arabs over the last 100 years. For this, as Bob said, I'm using the maps that were published in my atlas, and you can find this atlas and to download it free in 7 languages in my website, and of course, English is one of them. So let's start by describing you the Britain's three ways to gain control of the Middle East in the beginning of the 20th century during the First World War. And the first channel was with the Arabs. And here we can see the letter that was sent by Sir Henry McMahon to the Sheriff Hussein bin Ali, the king of Hijaz, and promised him to establish an Arab kingdom in the Arab areas of the Ottoman Empire. As you can see here on the left side, this kingdom planned to include Palestine, the land of Israel, the Transjordan, and of course Syria. And the second channel was with the world powers between United Kingdom and France, and this famous agreement that was signed in 1916 with the name Sykes-Picot about the distribution of the powers in the Middle East. And the idea in those days was not to establish any Jewish state or a national home for the Jewish state, for the Jewish people in the land of Israel. But the plan, as we can see here, was to establish here international special area without any attention to the Jewish people problem. And the last one, and maybe the most famous one, was of course Balfour Declaration that was given by the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Lord Balfour, to Chaim Weizmann. And the idea here was the commitment of the British government to establish a national home for the Jewish people in Palestine. And I emphasize this point because the idea was in Palestine and not Palestine will be the national home of the Jewish people. So this was the first milestone of this conflict. And from this stage, we move when the British and the international community gave the priority to the Jewish people by approve and by including the Balfour Declaration in the mandate of Palestine that was given in 1920 in San Remo conference, and then was approved by the League of Nations in 1922. Here we can see...
I just want to interrupt for 1 second because we're having, some people are concerned, they're not seeing the slides. They don't see the maps, only the first page. And I'm not sure if that's a technical problem that can be solved or not.
I see the maps. I don't know why the others, but do you see it, Bob?
No, he doesn't see him, and I don't either. So we just see the main. We just see on the main picture. We see the cover, and then on the side we see the maps. But they're not loading in for some reason.
I don't know what to say because I see the maps and the presentation, and the. The sharing is still active. Let me see. Okay, I try to do it again. I stopped sharing and now I'm trying to sharing it again. Okay, now it's okay?
No, I don't know if it It's a problem on our end. I don't know.
Again,
somebody just wrote that we have to play the PowerPoint. I don't know.
I know how to do it. It's not my first time. Okay.
Now it's working.
Now it's working? Okay. Okay. It's okay now?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so we can continue. Okay? So again, here we can see at this map, what was the decision in a San Remo conference that took place in April 1920, about three separate mandates, two for the British, Palestine, which included Transjordan and Iraq, Mesopotamia, and one for the French, Syria, which included also Lebanon. And the idea was to include in the mandate Balfour Declaration, means to establish in this area that we see here under the name Palestine, the national home of the Jewish people. Here, this is the first time when the borders of mandatory Palestine were determined by the international community, by the British and the French. And this is what we call mandatory Palestine or the land of Israel. And it's about 26,000 square kilometers. And the League of Nations approved this border that were determined by the French and the British.
Excuse me again, we've lost, we're still on the first map, the 1915 map.
Wow. I read here in the chat that other people can see it, the presentation. So I don't know what to say, but again, let me.
We're on recognition of the right of the Arab people now.
Yes, but this is really the first slide. And now? Do you see it, Bob?
It's still the same recognition slide.
I will do it again, but I'm not sure that I have a good answer to this problem because okay, do you see it now?
Yes, we do.
We've got the Peel Commission now.
Yes, it's about Peel Commission?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So I'm moving to the next milestone of the development of the Israeli borders and one more milestone of the Israeli-Arab conflict, and this about the recognition of the right of the Arab people in the mandatory Palestine for self-determination in this area. And the first time that it happened, it was by the Royal British Committee headed by Lord Peel. And here on the left side, we can see the map of their proposal, how to establish a very small Jewish state here, the gray area, which was less than 20% of the mandatory Palestine, especially in the coastal plain of the land of Israel and the Galilee area. And the rest of the area, almost 70% of the mandatory Palestine, planned to be part of Transjordan, headed by King Abdullah the First. And the last part of this proposal was to keep the British mandate on this area from Jerusalem because of the holy sites in Jerusalem via the airport in Lod until the seaport in Jaffa. So this was also the first time that the Zionist movement accepted the idea of partition in Palestine. The second proposal, which is the most famous proposal, and I'm talking about the partition plan, the United Nations Resolution 181 that took place in November 1947. And this was the proposal how to divide the mandatory Palestine into two independent states, one for the Jews, for the Jewish people. You see here the blue area, which covers 55% of the mandatory Palestine, okay? And the green area planned to be the Arab state, 45% of the mandatory Palestine. And the third paragraph related to the corpus separatum of Jerusalem, this very small area, but the most important area in the land of Israel, to be under the United Nations control for 10 years, and then to make a referendum to decide about the future political status of this area. As you know, the Arabs rejected for many reasons this resolution and started the war to cancel this resolution, of course, with the umbrella of the Arab world. But before, I would like to explain why the Zionist movement recognized and accepted the idea of partition of the land of Israel. Because from the beginning, the Zionist movement has three main national goals. The first one is, of course, the land of Israel. The second is to be a democratic state. And the third, to be with a Jewish identity. But because of the demographic balance between Arabs and Jews in mandatory Palestine, just to remind you that in 1937, there were only 30% Jews in the mandatory Palestine. And in 1947, there were only 33% Jews in the mandatory Palestine. It means that the Zionists, the Jewish people, cannot establish a democratic and the Jewish state in all over mandatory Palestine. So it means that the Zionist movement had to decide about the priority of those three strategic and national goals. And the decision was, of course, to have democratic state with a Jewish majority and to give up on part of the mandatory Palestine, means to accept the idea of establishing two separate states, one for the Jewish people, one for the Arab people in the mandatory Palestine. And I can tell you that we are dealing with the same issue even today. We have to decide about the character of the state of Israel. And we know that we have three main options. The first one, if we want to be Jewish state, but in what we call Eretz Yisrael HaShlema, the land of Israel, it means with the Arab majority that it will be apartheid state. If we want to be democracy, but not to divide this state, it means that it will be Arab state, because in democracy, the majority define the character of this state. So the only way to keep the state of Israel as a Jewish and democratic state, it's by division, by compromise, a compromise with the Palestinians about the size of each side state.
Excuse me, so, again, we are still on the Peel Commission slide.
It's a really unfortunate, Shaul. Maybe you can, yeah, that's good. Go. No.
Here, now, this is Peel Commission, but you see now the partition plan?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. And this diagram about the three national, yes. So I'm not going to repeat on this. I believe that now you can see this slide and this that show us the dilemma in front of the Jewish people of the Zionist movement about the priorities of three national or strategic goals that we have. And now, I'm moving to the stage when the Arab Israeli Arab wars determined the border of Israel. And the first one was, of course, 48 war. Here you can see that in the end of this war between Israel and five Arab countries, Israel signed the armistice agreement with Egypt, the first one in February 1949, and then with Lebanon, with Transjordan, and with Syria in July 1949. And here we have totally different borders and maps other than the partition plan. As you can notice, Israel has full territorial contiguity on the left side from Metula in the north via the coastal plain until Aqaba Bay here, Elat Bay. You see the blue area, which is almost 78% of the mandatory Palestine. It means that we increased the size of the state of Israel instead of 55% that were planned by the partition plan. Today, when we say Israel inside the green line, inside the 67 borders, or inside the armistice agreement line, we mean 78% of the mandatory Palestine. Half of the planned Arab state became part of Transjordan. And we know that King Abdullah annexed this area to his kingdom, and the Gaza Strip became under the responsibility of the Egyptian without any annexation of this area to Egypt. And what about Jerusalem? Jerusalem was divided. On the left side, here we can see West Jerusalem under the Israeli sovereignty, okay? On the other side here, this is El Quds, the original East Jerusalem that used to be under the Jordanian control for 19 years, between 48 to 67. This area included, of course, the old city of Jerusalem with the Walling Wall, Akotel Ma'aravi, and other holy sites that we have here. It was very small area, not more than 6 square kilometers, with two special areas. First of all, Mount Scopus as the militarized area here between Israel and Jordan. And also this part of the Governor Hill also was demilitarized area. And the second main war, of course, is the 67 war, when Israel took over Sinai Peninsula and Gaza Strip from Egypt, and the West Bank from Jordan, and the Golan Heights from Syria. One of the first things that the Israeli government, headed by Levi Eshkol from the Labor Party, did after the war was to unify Jerusalem and to enlarge Jerusalem, as we can see here on the right side of the of this slide. Israel decided to annex to Israel all this area, 70 square kilometers to West Jerusalem, which East, the original East Jerusalem was only this part, very small area, as I mentioned, of 6 square kilometers. Here in this area, we have today 12 Jewish neighborhoods. You see the blue area. And with 220,000 Israelis, and of course, 28 Palestinian villages and neighborhoods with 350,000 people. All of them are part of the United Jerusalem, the capital of Israel. Of course, according to the Israeli law, just to remind you that the international community refused to recognize this unilateral step that was taken by the Israeli government. And here I'm moving to the stage that peace agreements were, the peace agreements determined the Israeli border. And the first was, of course, between Israel and Egypt, here on the left side. The first of all, Israel and Egypt signed on framework agreement in Camp David summit that took place in 1978. And then 1 year later in 1979, they signed on the peace agreement and they implemented this agreement until 1982, when Israel totally withdrew from the Sinai Peninsula and evacuated all the Israeli settlements, especially here in Rafah area near Gaza Strip. The second peace treaty that took place between Israel and Jordan in 1994, here we can see the map. And I would like to emphasize one important thing, that this was the first time as a part of permanent status agreement that Israel and Arab country agreed to for land swap between them. As you can see here, the blue area were annexed to Israel, and the red area were annexed to Jordan. It was about 16.5 square kilometers, and it was very important for the fabric of life and for the validity of the Israeli moshavim and kibbutzim, the agricultural settlements in here in the Arava Valley. And from here, we are moving to the Oslo Agreement between the Israeli government and the PLO. And first of all, the first agreement, the DOP, Declaration of Principles, took place in 1993, as you know, but the most important agreement was signed in 1995, the interim agreement. It was about the distribution of the powers in the West Bank, what we call Area A, B, and C. And here I would like to elaborate a little bit, because this is the situation today in the the West Bank. The brown area, this is Area A, which covers 18% of the West Bank with 1.1 million Palestinians. Area A means that Israel transferred all responsibilities to the Palestinian Authority that was established in 1994. I mean security, law and order, and 41 civil responsibilities, like, you know, from sewage to education to zoning and planning, infrastructure, everything. The yellow area, this is Area B, which covers 22% of the West Bank. And area, the status, the legal status of Area B is very similar to Area A, but in Area B, Israel has an overriding responsibility for the security of the Israelis who are crossing this area. So in Area B, we have today 1.4 million Palestinians. It means that the current situation, only 40% of the West Bank are under the jurisdiction of the Palestinian Authority, with 90% of the Palestinian people. In Gaza Strip, the situation is totally different since summer 2005, when Israel implemented the disengagement plan and evacuated all the Israeli settlements in this area. The last thing, it's about Area C, the light green area, which is 60% of the West Bank, with all the Israeli settlements in this area. And I'm talking about the legal, according to the Israeli law, the legal settlements, 127 with 451,000 people, and all the other small illegal outposts, which is about 80 illegal outposts with 20,000 people. But also in Area C, we have almost 300 Palestinians who are living in this area. And from this point, I would like to move to the Camp David summit that took place in 2000 between the Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Barak and the chairman of the PLO, Yasser Arafat. And here on the left side, you can see what was, I don't say the generous proposal of Barack in this summit. On the left side, you see the map. What was the idea? The idea was to annex to Israel the blue area that you can see here, which is about 11% of the West Bank, but also to have a long-term lease of the green area because of the Israeli security needs. It means that the real proposal of Barak to Yasser Arafat was to go home and to establish the Palestinian state on something about 82-83% of the territories. Why Arafat rejected it? Because the Palestinian position lays on their interpretation of United Nations Security Council Resolution 242 that took place in November 1967 after Six-Day War. And the interpretation means that all territories for peace means to have for the Palestinian state 22% of the mandatory Palestine. But the Israeli position lays on the Israeli interest. And one of the Israeli interests in this area, of course, it's about the settlers. And this huge challenge to evacuate 100,000 of Israelis who are living beyond the 67 line. So what was the idea? How to bridge this gap? How to bridge or to decrease this tension between the Israeli and the Palestinian position? The idea was by land swap. It means that Israel can keep under its sovereignty most of the Israelis who are living beyond the 67 borders, but Israel also has to compensate the Palestinians with the same size of area inside Israel. In this way, Palestine will get 22% of the mandatory Palestine. But in Camp David, and I was there in this in the Israeli delegation, Ehud Barak refused to accept this formula, and he asked or demands to annex the blue area to Israel without any compensation to the Palestinians. It was worse referring to the Jerusalem. You can see here on the right side what was the Israeli proposal, Ehud Barak's proposal in Camp David. Ehud Barak was ready to give up only on the Palestinian villages that were annexed to Jerusalem in 1967 after Six-Day War. But he wasn't ready to give up on El-Quds, the original East Jerusalem that used to be under the Jordanian control, this area, the yellow area, and also to keep the Israeli sovereignty on the Temple Mount, something that Yasser Arafat said that he doesn't have the authority to take the decision about this area, which is the third important site for the Muslim world. And 6 months later, we went to Taba after President Clinton came out with his parameters in December 2000. And again, you can see here on the right side, the Israeli position for annexing 6% of the West Bank. You see here the blue area with the Israeli main settlements blocks like Ariel or like Modi'in Elit or like Givat Ze'ev, Ma'ale Adumim, Etzion bloc, okay? And the Palestinian proposal was about 3%. You can see here for the Israeli annexation, but they demand to have a land swap on the one, on one-to-one ratio, mean that Israel has to transfer them 3% of the territories. And this was really the last round of Oslo process about the permanent status agreement. And then we faced unilateral moves. First of all, what Israel did in May 2000, that about the unilateral withdrawal from Lebanon to the international border that was defined in 1923 between France and the United Kingdom. You see here the map, and about the disengagement plan. Here you see Gaza Strip with the 17 Israeli settlements that Ariel Sharon, the Israeli prime minister, decided to evacuate all of them with 8,000 settlers, and also to evacuate four small settlements in the near Jenin here, like Kadim and Ganim, and also to build the separation barrier, the security barrier here inside the West Bank. You see the red line, which is the line of the separation barrier, keeping most of the Israeli settlers on the Israeli side of the barrier. And the last negotiation was between Mahmoud Abbas, who replaced Yasser Arafat, and the Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Olmert. It took place in Annapolis 2007-2008. And this was the first time that both sides agreed on the parameter for the territorial issue, means 67 borders as a basis and a land swap on one-to-one ratio. So on the left side, you can see the Israeli proposal to annex to Israel the blue area, which is 6.5% of the territories, and to compensate the Palestinians with the same size of area, the green area inside Israel. This was the first time that the Israeli prime minister offered by map area inside Israel for the land swap. On the other side here, you can see the Palestinian proposal, which was more modest, of course. They talk about 2% of land swap. You see the blue area, and to have the same size of area inside Israel, the green area, especially around Gaza Strip, to enlarge this small area of Gaza Strip. And what was about Jerusalem? They decided to divide East Jerusalem according to the demographic line, means that the Jewish neighborhoods in East Jerusalem will remain under the Israeli sovereignty, and the Arab neighborhoods will be under the Palestinian sovereignty. So here on the left side, you see the Israeli proposal keeping the 12 Jewish neighborhoods under the Israeli sovereignty, okay? But also one small Palestinian village with the name Bet Safafa because of its location. On the other side, you can see Mahmoud Abbas' proposal under the same parameter. He asked to keep all the Palestinian villages, including Bet Safafa, under the Palestinian sovereignty, but also Ar Choma neighborhood because of the location of Ar Choma. Ar Choma is harming the Palestinian contiguity between Bethlehem and East Jerusalem. And just to remind you that Israel built Ar Choma after they signed on the DOP Oslo agreement. Okay? And here we can see what we faced 2 years ago, almost 2 years ago, the deal of the century, the peace vision of President Trump, that as you know, he used the same terms about two-state solution, but the details of this plan were totally different from the parameters and from the proposal that we faced during the Oslo and Annapolis process. Just to show you on the left side, the map of Trump's vision for peace, to annex to Israel all the blue area, which is almost 30% of the territories, but to compensate the Palestinians with half size of the area here near the border with Egypt, and keep almost 25 Israeli settlements as enclaves in the Palestinian state, and also 43 Palestinian villages as enclaves in the Israeli side. And what about Jerusalem? To keep Jerusalem, United Jerusalem, under the Israeli sovereignty, and to establish the Palestinian capital only here, you see this part, which is outside of the separation barrier, very small area with refugee camp, together with one more refugee camp, Shuafat, as the capital of Palestine, and to keep the original Al-Quds, original East Jerusalem, together with the old city, with the Temple Mount, Haram al-Sharif, all this area under the Israeli sovereignty. And my last slide is about the proposal for a permanent border between Israel and Palestine, something that both sides can accept. Here on the right side, you see Geneva Initiative that took place in 2003. Just to remind you that it was non-official initiative, but idea here is to use the same parameter, 67 border as a basis and the land swap on one-to-one ratio. And it was about 2.2% of land swap, as you can see here. Or one more idea, which is the output of very deep research that I did for the commanders of for Israel security 4 years ago, and it's about 4% of land swap without harming the Palestinian contiguity and without harming the Palestinian fabric of life, and to keep also the Israeli contiguity. By adopting this proposal, Israel can keep 80% of the Israelis who are living beyond the 67 line under its sovereignty. So until this point, I hope that everyone succeeds to see the maps. As I said, you can find all of them in my atlas in different languages. And I describe here the main milestones of the development of the Israeli borders, but also the development of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And now I'm ready for your questions.
Thank you, Shaul, so much for the informative presentation, and thanks to our audience for the patience with some of our technical difficulties. So start with a question about Ehud Barak, his negotiations. We have two questions about it. First is from Eric. He's asking what was the state of Israel's economy when Barak made additional demands to the Palestinian negotiators. And Jacqueline Schwartz is asking what do people mean when they say that Barak offered a great deal and it was rejected by the Palestinians?
Okay, look, as I said, Israel, headed by Barak and also headed by Yitzhak Rabin, had different interpretation for United Nations Resolution 242. We didn't accept the idea that we have to give up on the entire area and entire territories for peace. Even we did it with the peace agreement with Egypt and with the peace agreement with Jordan. The idea was to establish a political entity less than state. This is what Yitzhak Rabin said in his speech that took place in October 1995 in the Israeli Knesset. So Ehud Barak was the first prime minister that really offered to the Palestinians a proposal how to establish their independent state. But as I said, it was it contradicted the interpretation not only of the Palestinians but also of the international community about United Nations Resolution 242. And I know that in this resolution they wrote about territories and not all the territories, but the international community emphasized more than once this point that we are dealing with 22% for the Palestinian state and the rest 78% for Israel. So maybe it was generous, but not generous and fair enough for the Palestinians.
Our next question is from Alida, and she's they're asking what happened in Taba, in the negotiations in Taba, and why those broke down.
In Taba, Taba took place in 2001. And just to remind you that we went to Taba when Ehud Barak decided to go to the new election because he has a minority government. But in Taba, as I said, Taba lays on the parameters that President Clinton presented in December 2000. And for the territorial issue, the idea of Clinton was to give free of charge to Israel 9% of the territories. Means that the Palestinian state will cover only 97% of the territories. But also, according to Clinton parameter, Israel can make a land swap with the Palestinians of 3%. And also in this case, and I was responsible in Taba for the territorial negotiation, and when I presented the first map, and it was about 8%, 2% more than Clinton offer, the Palestinians told us, first of all, we want to see 6% only. And when I came with the 6%, Ehud Barak refused to offer the 3% for land swap. And the Palestinians asked for 3% of the land swap because this was Clinton a parameter, but Barak refused to offer any land inside the, Israel. So the gap was about 3% for the territorial issue, but there were also other gaps in the refugees issue and also for Jerusalem. But basically, we have to remember that it was the last days of Barak government, and we didn't have enough time to bridge all the gaps that we faced during this negotiation.
Thank you. Murray is asking, would it be true to say that Mahmoud Abbas will never accept the deal as he would be thrown from power?
I think it's a wrong assumption. You know, Abbas and Ehud Olmert in Annapolis 2007-2008, the most important thing that they achieved together was to agree on the four parameters how to deal with the four main issues of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. As I already mentioned, for a border, it was 67 border as a basis, and the land swap on one-to-one ratio. For Jerusalem, divide East Jerusalem according to the demographic line, and special case for the old city. For security, to have demilitarized Palestinian state with many other security arrangements for Israel. And for refugees, to solve the refugee issue, but not by return to Israel. The gaps were about, there were technical gaps and not principles gaps. So as you can see, say like Israeli, that Ehud Olmert offered a real generous proposal to Mahmoud Abbas, the Palestinian can say the same thing. Mahmoud Abbas offer a real and generous proposal to Ehud Olmert. Just to remind you the details, he offered a land swap. He offered also to have demilitarized Palestinian state. He offered to divide East Jerusalem and to keep 11 Israeli neighborhoods under the Israeli sovereignty. He asked for a symbolic implementation of the right of return. So this was very generous from the Palestinian side, an offer how to solve all those issues. And what we need to say, and this is exactly what Mahmoud Abbas always said, and also Ehud Olmert, that they didn't finish their negotiation. There were gaps between their positions, but no one of them refused to the other a proposal. There was a process how to reach and how to bridge the gaps in each issue. But as you know, what happened with Ehud Olmert, and this was the end of Annapolis process and the negotiation between the sides.
We have a question from Barry Cates about the tone of the negotiations. As someone who personally was involved in some of these negotiations, did you experience it as hostile, professional, confrontational, or anything else? And I would also like to loop in another anonymous question about referring to al-Nakba or the catastrophe. From 47-48, was that also part of the negotiations, or how, what part that played in them?
Okay. So, as I mentioned, refugee, the Palestinian refugee issue was one of the main issues of this negotiation. And we didn't deal with the right of return. We tried to deal how to solve the refugee issue. And the solution was to let the Palestinian to absorb their refugees according to their ability to do this, but not to return to Israel. Because we know, because the return of the Palestinian refugee to Israel, it means to harm the Jewish identity of the state of Israel. So we put the focus on this issue about on compensations. And just to remind you that in United Nations Resolution 194, which is dealing with the refugee issue, there were two options. One, to return to Palestine or to Israel. And the second, it's about compensation. And the idea was to adopt this second option about compensation and not to return to Israel. And of course, there was a huge and very long discussion about recognition of the suffered of the two peoples in this conflict, about the Israeli responsibility. But in the end of the day, both sides understood that if we want to solve this issue, it's not by trying to establish a common narrative. It's by compromise. I believe that we gave good answer and good solution for the Palestinian refugee. About my participation in the negotiation, first of all, I would like to emphasize that I was in military these days. My official function was the head of the peace administration, and I was responsible for preparing the Israeli positions for the negotiation, but not for the negotiation. Sometimes, like Taba summit, I participated in the negotiation, but according to the orders of Prime Minister Barak or others before Barak. And I would like to tell you that in the beginning of every meeting that we had with the Palestinians, it was, you know, ventilation about who is blaming the others about this issue and others, but then we turn to the solution, trying to find the creative solution to bridge the gap. And of course, the problem was about the different perception of both sides about what is the real interpretation of 242 and what we can do with the Israeli settlers and what kind of security arrangements we need to agree on to keep Israel safe. But really, it was very professional negotiation between both sides.
Okay, next we have a few questions about the two-state solution. Is it still a viable way forward, especially with the number and size of Israeli settlements in the West Bank? What do you have to answer to that?
Okay. You know, to ask this question, we have to deal with three different dimensions about the feasibility of two-state solution. First of all, the first dimension, it's about the physical and the spatial dimension. Can we divide the West Bank into two states or not? And the answer is yes, it's positive. We can do it according to the parameters that took place in Annapolis process, and I already mentioned them. And I published more than once articles and research about this. You can find everything in my website, the English version in my website, all the maps and all the articles and the research. But the real challenge and the real problem is that we don't have today the political feasibility for two-state solution, because the Israeli government, the current one, and also all the government under Benjamin Netanyahu, refuse to accept the parameters, those four parameters, to resume the negotiation with the Palestinians. And we know that 2 years ago, it took place in February 2019, that more than 40 Knesset members and ministers came out with a declaration, Shamir declaration, that they are giving their commitment for the Israeli settlements in the West Bank to bring 2 million Israelis to the West Bank, to cancel the idea of a two-state solution and to establish one state for one people here. So this is the Israeli reposition, as we know, even John Kerry came out with his announcement in Doha 3 years ago that he said that the Israeli government is not ready for a peace agreement according to the known parameters. Also, we have a problem on the Palestinian side. The split between Fatah and Hamas, between Gaza Strip and the West Bank, without democratic election, we don't have a real single address on the Palestinian side who can resume the negotiation and to sign the permanent status agreement with Israel. They need their election, they need their reform in the PLO, and this is the situation. So I'm not, I don't believe that in the coming years we are going to face any progress in this process, but I insist to say that we have the physical feasibility for two-state solution. And I can tell you that the Israeli settlements enterprise failed to achieve its political goals to create the right conditions to let Israel to annex the West Bank or even part of the West Bank without harming the Zionist vision of Jewish and democratic state.
And we have a question about the 2020 land swap proposal. How do you justify handing over kibbutzim land along the Gaza border to maintain the status quo with the West Bank settlers? It's coming from Ayala, who is a native of Kibbutz Kisufim in the south of Israel.
Okay. I know that it's very hard, you know, to give up on their land in what we call Gaza envelope. And I know them very, very well. I serve as a brigade commander in Gaza Strip almost 30 years ago, and I was born in Ashkelon, very close to Gaza, and I have so many friends in Gaza envelope kibbutzim. But we have to look at this in a national, as a national interest. And we know that it's impossible for any Israeli government to evacuate 500,000 Israelis from the West Bank. So the solution, the only solution, it's a land swap idea. And I would like to say that this will be with compensation for the kibbutzim in Otef Aza. And when we draw down the line for the land swap, we keep a buffer zone of 1 kilometer for each Israeli kibbutz to the new border. And we have very detailed plan how to compensate them with agricultural land in a different area inside Israel. But I must to say that the people there I don't know if all of them, but most of them are ready for this deal, because this is, again, the only way to bridge the gap about the territorial issue.
Thank you, Shaul. And we have one last question about the Transjordan area. Meyer is asking, why was the West Bank initially transferred to Transjordan and not established as an independent Palestinian state? And another question from John about the percentages of land of the British Mandate. Why are they not calculated with what became Transjordan? If you do those calculations, the division of land between Jewish and Arab areas completely changes.
Okay, let's start with the second question. First of all, just to know that I published a new book 6 months ago dealing with the 12 myths of the Israeli about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and this is one of them, about Transjordan. Just to remind you that the commitment of the British government and also the commitment of the League of Nations wasn't about establishing a Jewish state in Palestine, in entire Palestine, but in Palestine. Okay? So it means that according to their calculations and their interests, they can establish the national home for the Jewish state in part of Palestine. They didn't give any commitment for the entire Palestine. And I can tell you more than that. In January 1919, when the Jewish Zionist agency came to Paris to present their proposal for the borders of the land of Israel for Palestine, they didn't ask to have Transjordan. Only very small area of this, less than 20% of the size of the of Jordan today. It means that we didn't ask something, or let me say in other words, they didn't take from us an area that we never asked for to have it as a part of the land of Israel. So, and after 48 war, there was a very ugly struggle between Jordan, between King Abdullah the First and the Palestinians, who is the legitimate representative of the Palestinian people. Abdullah and then his grandson Hussein insist to be the representative of the Palestinian people, and not Husseini or others later, the PLO. So this is the reason why they didn't establish an independent Palestinian state in the territories, especially in the West Bank. It happened only in 1988, in July, when King Hussein gave up on the annexation of the West Bank and recognized PLO as the legitimate and the only representative of the Palestinian people. This was the first push to Oslo agreement. In the same year, the PLO recognized 181 and 242 resolutions that opened the door for Oslo agreement. And I think that I answered on both questions.
Yes, that's excellent. Thank you very much, Shaul, for your time and all the answers. And over to you, Bob.
Okay.
First of all, that was a real tour de force. I am so impressed. I'm going to have to play it again a couple of times to get it all straight in my mind. But it was exceptional, and I think that's the general tone that most of us had. I apologize to the audience for the technical issues at the beginning. I'm glad that we were able to get them resolved. And do download the book, because it really is an eye-opener. You'll get a great deal of benefit from it. Thank you very, very much, Dr. Arieli. It was a pleasure to have you. And I know that we have had, I think, more guests than almost any webinar we've ever done. We have guests from across Canada. We have guests from California. We have guests from Israel, even. And I think that shows the importance people place on what you're doing. So thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Bob. And I would like to say to the audience two things. First of all, you have my website, shaularieli.com, and can use free this website. You can find there so many articles, books, PowerPoint presentation, maps, everything to use. And something, the second thing is I published 3 months ago a new book in English with the name A Border Between Us. You can find it in Amazon. And it's and in this book, I'm describing the history of this conflict since Balfour Declaration until today, dealing with the four main issues of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And again, thank you.
Okay. And if you look at the chat, it's amazing. We've just got one person after another saying thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bye. Bye-bye. Litraot. Bye.